thanks to the entire Gulf South community for making Ochsner Medical Center one of the nation's best hospitals. At Ochsner, we are passionate about relentlessly pursuing advancements to overcome the toughest healthcare challenges. That's why U.S. News & World Report once again ranked us the number one hospital in Louisiana and in the top 50 in the nation in three specialties. Discover how we're putting big ideas to work at Ochsner.org/relentless. Ochsner, innovating healthcare.
Everybody, Bunkhouse Bob and Lovely Lori here. Folks, does the man make the title, or does the title make the man? Age-old question with a simple answer. That is, if you're wearing a title made by Top Rope Belts.
Established in 2006, and with a satisfied client list, including Lucha Underground, the LA Dodgers, New Japan Pro Wrestling, Ohio Valley Wrestling, the National Wrestling Alliance, and many, many more. Top Rope Belts uses 100% custom drawing and does all of their own etching. That means quality from start to finish, folks.
Folks, whether you're a private collector, a wrestling promotion, or a business who wants a quality championship title belt, look no further than Top Rope Belts. Check them out on Facebook or visit them at www.topropebelts.com.
Buddy, this is Bunkhouse Bob.
And the Lovely Laura.
Live from the Armory Wrestling Show, folks, we're heard on more platforms than an Olympic diver. FNX.network, iTunes, Stitcher, Blog Talk Radio. You can't turn a corner without running into one of us, and you'd rather run into me than you would Laura.
Ain't that the truth?
Wednesday night, 7 o'clock Eastern Time, live from the Armory Wrestling Show, the premier podcast of independent wrestling. You better listen.
Whoop.
Welcome to Live from the Armory Wrestling Show, the premier podcast of indie wrestling.
We are the yin and the yang, the peanut butter and the jelly, the lettuce and the tomato of wrestling podcasts. Well, yeah, sure. I know that you're kidding, and please don't call me Shirley.
Our studio line is area code 213-816-1605. With your host, Bunkhouse Bob.
In the wrestling world, there is 6 degrees of separation between myself and professional wrestling. I'm like the Kevin Bacon of professional wrestling.
And the lovely Laura.
Diarrhea is one of those words that just sounds wonderful when you say it. Diarrhea, but not so wonderful in, you know, definition.
Hey, everybody. Thanks for tuning in to Live from the Armory Wrestling Show. My name is the Bunkhouse Bob, and I am the greatest wrestling mind of the 21st century. Folks, we thank you for listening tonight. Tonight is episode 234 of the program. And coming up here in about a half hour, we are going to have on the Southern Stomper. Luke Hawx makes his return to Live from the Armory Wrestling Show. I haven't talked to Luke in about 3 years, and we got a lot to catch up on. Again, folks, we thank you for checking out the show, no matter where you're listening at, however you're listening to the program. If you listen as we do it live on Blog Talk Radio, you catch us on FNX, iTunes, Stitcher, all that other junk. We'll get into that in a little bit. We just thank you very much for your support. While you're out dancing around on the internet tonight, please check out @indie_customs. Give them a follow on Twitter. We would also encourage you to go to www.prowrestlingtees.com. And if you go to that website and you type in FNX into the search bar, you'll find two Live from the Armory Wrestling Show shirts to choose from. We would ask that you would purchase a shirt and help support the show. It's a great cause. The show is a great cause, a labor of love, if you will. We would ask that you would also go over to www.fnx.network and check out all the great content that's available on the network. Question for myself or Laura or George about a guest or an opinion or whatever that you hear on this program, you can always send us an email, and you can find us at asktheArmory@gmail.com. Before we get too deep into the program tonight, I'd like to remind everybody that October is Breast Cancer Awareness Month, and we here at the program totally support that. So to all those that are survivors, those that are looking for a cure, those that are raising funds, please, if you have the opportunity to donate or participate to that cause, please do so. And making her long-awaited return to the show, and whenever Laura's gone, it always feels like an eternity. I can't say that it's going to be more shocking than what fans were when they saw Shawn Michaels' bald head on Raw, but nonetheless, I would like to welcome back to the program the co-host of this show, the lovely Laura. Hi, Laura.
Hello, Bob.
How are you?
I am fine. How about you?
Not too bad, not too bad. And before we get carried away into this episode, I wanted to take a moment and I wanted to officially apologize on behalf of George Coles for the remarks that he made on this program last week, challenging your mental capacity. I know that George is racked with guilt, and I just wanted to let you know that he's sorry.
Bob, you must think that I fell off the turnip truck yesterday. It wasn't George that was saying that I had a weakened mental capacity. It was your lying ass. That's who said that. You.
I don't remember anything like that at all. I don't.
Of course
I,
you don't.
We were carried away with the progressive liberal Dan Richards last week, and we almost got knee-deep into a straw poll, and I think for a minute that George thought we were in Iowa, and he was getting ready to climb on the stump. I had to pull him back
straw.
Down.
Yeah, turkey was, in the was, straw, that's what it was, and you the
I
turkey.
I agree. No, it is like what the turkey bowl from TNA back in the day, you know, feast or fire.
Uh-huh.
And I had to put on the suit and all that, so
I
don't know.
That,
I'm glad
that's
you're back.
Okay, Bob, because I know that I have a brain and I use it, and
absolutely.
I got upset over what you had said, but the thing about it is
yeah.
that, you know, your opinion of me means nothing
mm-hmm.
to me.
I know,
so,
because isn't today like National Mean Girls Day?
On Wednesdays we wear pink, yes.
Yes, National Mean Girls Day.
Now, let me say this. I've never seen this movie.
You haven't?
So, no, I have not. So,
like
the only reason
classic.
I know, it is a cult classic, so I hear, but the only reason I know anything about it is because people at work made me dress up in pink today because of it.
Okay.
And things of that nature. I've seen things online about it, so, you know, I had no idea what it was until a couple of days ago. But I know what you're trying to say is you're trying to say that I am a mean girl, but I am not.
No, I'm not trying to say that at all. I just was just going with what I saw, that it's National Mean Girls Day. I just thought I'd throw that out there.
You might as well just go ahead and throw yourself under the bus, because that's where you're heading.
I know.
You just keep on digging that hole deeper. You just keep on. And see, when I don't normally listen to the show when I'm not on it. So I don't know what you've said about me. I need to go back and listen to some old shows where I've not been on, because who knows what you've said about me. Because here I have, you know, listened to the progressive liberal, and here is the end of the show. First of all, I have bone to pick with George Coles saying that Dolph Ziggler's hair looks like ramen noodles. I have bone to pick with George Coles. And then I hear you tell people that you don't use all your brain capacity when I'm on the show because you don't want to confuse me. Bob, if brains were dynamite, you couldn't blow your nose. So, with that being said,
Okay.
I'm going to go on and talk about the places I've been and the people I have seen.
Okay. All right. You can do that. I'm not
your little thing ruin what John and I did last Wednesday. I ventured down to Queen City, which is Charlotte,
yes,
for those not in the know.
Yes.
And John and I headed over to the Comedy Zone, which is in Uptown Charlotte. And I'm going to say this just for full disclosure, but I had ordered the tickets, and it never had on their time, and not on their website, day of, when the meet and greet was. Normally, when you go to these comedy shows, the meet and greet's after the show.
Yeah.
Well, we're taking our time. We're at Texas Roadhouse eating, and one of John's friends, Adrian Rohr, texts him, like, where are you at? And John's like, well, the door's not open until blah, blah, blah. And Adrian's like, no, Dolph's here and doing the meet and greet. Did you guys not get an email? And John's like, did you not get an email today? I'm like, looking through my email. I looked in my spam folder. Nothing. They sent out an email. They backed up the time of which they were going to open the doors. And they had meet and greet from 6:30 to 7:30. It was 6 to 7:30. It was something like an hour and a half. And so we're still in Matthews, which is still probably a good 20, 30 minutes away if traffic is good. We're talking, this is like 5-6 o'clock Charlotte's traffic. Okay.
Right.
So I call the place and I'm like, you know, I didn't get this email. You know, the only reason I know anything about it is because a friend of mine's there and happened to text me and asking me, where am I? And basically, at first they were like, well, you know, I don't know what to tell you. And I'm like, I just paid $40. Yeah, I don't know what to tell you. I'm like, I paid $40 for these tickets apiece. Called me Dolph Ziggler. And, I don't know what to tell you. I said, can you put somebody on the phone who does? So get on the phone with the manager, and he's like, you can still come. I'm like, well, yeah, no shit, Sherlock. I know I can still come and enjoy the show, but I wanted to meet Dolph Ziggler. I promise when you get here, you can meet Dolph Ziggler. So we get there. It's pouring rain. John lets me out. I'm heading for the Comedy Zone, which is in the basement of this place.
Right.
I get there. And I go up to the guy, and I said, you know, I've got the meet and greet, the VIP. He doesn't even look at my ticket. Slaps a green band on me, and I go get in line.
Right.
I will bet there were people in that line that didn't even pay for that.
Really?
Seriously. The most unorganized thing I'd ever seen in my whole life. But besides getting to all this, so I get up. It's in line and talking to Dolph, and he's so nice. He's like, hey, how are you? I'm like, I'm fine. How about you? And I said, I just want to thank you. And he just kind of looked at me. I said, I want to thank you for reincorporating your wiggle into your ring entrance. And he just laughed. He said, you know, they made me stop that for a while. And
really?
I was like, well, they need to let you keep doing it. And so the Susan G. Coleman, the shirts they used to do, I don't know whether they still do them anymore, but every superstar had their own cancer shirt. So I had a Dolph Ziggler one on, and he said he liked my shirt. Such a nice guy, a truly nice guy who loves his fans. I saw a picture of him with a woman's pocketbook on in the picture. So, no, we don't have to put that down with it. I'll just hold it. But just so nice. He autographed a figure for me. And, George, I had my Dolph Ziggler bracelet on that you gave me some time ago. And, really, this guy is, like, the greatest. He really and truly is. I'm not just saying that. But he's probably the friendliest wrestler I've ever met in my whole entire life.
Really?
There for the fans. Absolutely. His stand-up is stuff about WWE and some of the stuff that came out of his mouth about WWE, and I'm not going to say it because I don't want to get him in trouble. But you're just like, holy hell. And I'm thinking, I know why you don't get those pushes anymore, because, you know, he's just not – he's very candid about his issues with WWE. Somebody at the end of the comedy show, he had a friend with him, Sarah – I can't remember her last name, but I'll remember it before the end of the show. She was great. She's from Georgia, had a great stand-up act. And they did a Q&A at the end, and so someone had written, "Do you hate Roman Reigns too?" And one of the questions was, what would be your porn star name? If you were a porn star, what would your name be? He said, if I were a porn star? And somebody yelled out Xavier Woods, and I thought the whole place was going to die laughing. Charles Robinson, Lil Nate was in the audience that night. I saw our good friend Montana Black and Darius Lockhart. Got to see them. So it was a great – he's really good. Now, he does his act by laying a notebook on the stool. But it's really good. His timing is good. Some of the things he tells you about WWE, and he dropped a little bomb on us, which I can't really divulge on air, but I'll tell you and George about it off air, because I don't want to get him in trouble. Because he was like, if anyone is videotaping this, I'm in deep shit, you know? So I don't want to get him in trouble. Basically what he said, I'm in deep shit. And but seriously, if he comes to your area, go see him, because it's very frank and very candid about what goes on in wrestling, and he is just a really super guy. I've seen him at like Access, like when his time was over, he was still in going down the line and signing stuff for people. You know, he let John take a picture of me and him, and then he let me take a selfie of him. So, just a great guy.
Let me ask you,
enough about him.
Let me ask you this. Was all of his material WWE-themed comedy material,
mostly,
or did he go off in any other different direction? Or
He talked about being single, you know, and using dating apps and things of that nature. But a lot of it was, you know, WWE stuff. And that's why they don't allow video.
Right. Okay.
You know, in
That makes sense. I mean, if he's telling backstage stories or stuff that, you know, that, you know, isn't or shouldn't be made public, you know, through video, through a different media, then I could see it. I guess this kind of goes with our Twitter poll this week, which we'll get to in a minute. But let me ask you this. If it were not then for his WWE career, is stand-up comedy a thing that he could do given other material? I know you mentioned his timing. Is that something? Or is this a niche thing because he's a WWE wrestler? You know, he's been given this platform.
Definitely he's been given this platform because he's a WWE wrestler. That place was cram-packed full. He seemed like he was surprised. And I'm like, dude, this is Charlotte. If it's wrestling, people are going to come. It doesn't matter what it is. If it's wrestling-related, you're going to get an audience. And I'm sure the one in Greensboro was packed, too, because he did the next night in Greensboro at their Comedy Zone. But I think, you know, the WWE stuff is certainly what brings them in. But I would go back because I liked his timing was good. I mean, you can tell he's working on it.
Yeah.
And
it's a work in progress.
Stand-up
comedy is a thing on its own, you know. I mean, there's some people that are incredibly funny. I mean, what was that one show that used to be on? I think it was on, like, HBO. It had, like, the
Def Comedy Jam.
Was it Def Comedy Jam or Live from the Improv or something
that was a
like
different
that?
Live from the Improv, Death Comedy Jam was a favorite of mine in college. Myself and my roommate would stay up late to watch Martin and just people like Chris Tucker and people like that who are superstars now, you know, just getting their start, you know.
You just didn't know what you were going to get. Some people were incredibly funny, and then there were other people.
Right.
It was just like,
they were not.
Yeah, they weren't.
But this one, I would, you know, I'd go back. Of course, it's off. Okay. I'd go back. But, right. but, you know, I think this is something he could do afterward. You know, he's working on it. You know, basically, he's like, you know, I just wrestle to pay the bills. And, yeah. you know, I will say this. The chick that was with him is a friend of his, Sarah, and she was so nice. She was so Southern and so nice. And her mom makes little doggy and cat bandanas, and she was selling doggy and cat bandanas with the Dolph Ziggler print. And, of course, I
really?
Bought two. Yes, of course I bought two. But she was talking
for a
about,
buck.
Exactly, $5.
Yeah.
I paid her that. Her mom made them. You know, hey, but
right.
she did mention in something that I've always said that he makes people look good. And she was like, you know, it's a shame that people can't see that and have other people make you look good. You know, Dolph is one of the best sellers in the whole business.
Yeah, I mean, I, and if there's ever been a standing criticism of his ring work in the ring, out of the ring, behind the curtain, you know, that he's too vocal. The in-ring part is that he actually oversells. And
right.
I guess, you know, it's, you know, which flavor of ice cream do you like, chocolate or vanilla? You know, I mean, there are nights
right.
that, you know, you're going to get people that are going to say that he oversells
like
or he's not selling enough.
Right.
Yeah, you know, it's just, you know, what it is, what it is. I think fans appreciate that. I mean, that's part of the art of the dance, you know, is the ability
I
to make somebody else look good. I believe
and,
so.
And, you know,
I believe.
One of George's criticisms of him is that he's never had a memorable feud. And I don't really think that's his fault. You know, that's poor booking, poor writing. But I think, and he also talked about, real quick, I want to tell you, he, of course, now this was the weekend, this is a couple of days after Hell in the Cell. He
mm-hmm.
was scared she totally to death up on that cage.
Yeah.
Scared to death. Because
I
what
bet.
Happened was he came out there in Converse, in Chuck Taylor's. He couldn't get a grip in the side. You know, they've got the holes cut out for you to get a grip in your foot in the side. Couldn't do it because the Converse are too slick on the bottom.
Yeah, they're not much tread
he,
on the bottom of those.
Right, and you wore Converse. I have too. And
yeah.
there's just not a whole lot of anything to them. They're just, you know, they're cool shoes, but they're shitty on your
yeah.
feet.
Yeah.
But he said, you know, he said he'd never been that scared in his whole entire life doing wrestling. He said, I don't like ladder matches, even though he's like, I've been in like 10 million. I don't like them. But he was scared to death, scared teetotally to death. I was scared for him, just to be honest with you, because watching all that, I was scared for Seth, and I was scared for Dean, and scared for Drew McIntyre. Because, like, you know, I'm like, we're going to have a replay of what happened 20 years ago. Somebody's going to fall through this damn cage, and what if they fall on someone on the ground?
Yeah, it's a scary proposition.
It sure is, and I just wanted to share that with you. That you know, wrestlers are people too. You know.
Yeah.
But seriously, folks, if Dolph does come to you, I mean, I don't know how much it costs to get into Access. I've never been. But I would much rather pay $40 to be guaranteed some time with him than to pay whatever it is for Access. You go wait in the line, and you're not guaranteed that he's going to be up there when you get up. So I'm just saying, take advantage of things, just like we talk about indie wrestlers. Take advantage of take advantage of these opportunities that come around. I will say this real quick. This is funny. Someone thought they'd be all cool and everything and asked Dolph what New Japan star he'd like to wrestle. He
uh-huh.
said Nakamura. And someone was like, well, don't you watch New Japan? He's like, hell, I don't watch SmackDown. What do you think I'm going to watch?
that's a funny reply. That's a funny reply. That's a funny
but, you know, I will stop gushing, but I just had a wonderful time. John and I had a wonderful time. Dolph was really great to John. But, you know, I can tell that he likes the lady. So
I'm sure that he does. I'm sure that he does. Do you want to go on and pull up the Twitter poll? Do you got your tablet handy?
I do have my tablet handy. Let me go onto the Twitter machine here. George comes up with some doozies on these Twitter polls, I must say. And I will say that I appreciate George for trying to take up with me, take up for me, rather, and tell Bob he was getting ready to get a sock in the mouth at WrestleCade, one of many that he's got coming to him. Does a pro wrestling background help wrestlers in other media like movies, comedy, or music? Yes and no, people. Yes, 67%. No, 33%. And I am going to have to say yes as well, especially in some things, as far as like stunts, perhaps. You know, wrestlers already know how to fall. You know, they got timing down. Comedy, the wrestling experience lends to a good routine. John Cena just finished wrapping a movie in China with Jackie Chan. Freaking Chan. So,
yeah, he does some
you
crazy
know,
stuff.
It is just amazing that, you know, wrestlers do this. And, you know, acting, I think wrestlers are natural actors for the most part because that's what they're doing anyway. They're being a character.
I think this comes out of Mr. Coles's loaded filing cabinet question folder, in my opinion, because on one hand, I totally agree. And then on the other hand, it's like, maybe, but not so much. I mean, you know, it's like with the comedy thing, you know, like with Dolph Ziggler, you know, 90% of his material is based off of, you know, wrestling. But, you know, the other 10%, you know, may just go off into another area. There have been other people that have made, you know, a transition into film. John Cena, Mike the Miz, even though these are WWE studio films, not so much with Cena. Later on, he got into, you know, mainstream acting. But, I mean, one of the guys that we had on the program this year, Sick Mondo, is doing stunts out in Hollywood. I follow him on Facebook, and he posts some videos of some stunt work that he's been doing. So I think that there is, and I think that there is, and I think that now I think the opportunity is more prevalent than what it was several years ago. I mean, there have always been opportunities for perhaps modeling or even back in the Attitude Era, the Playboy shoots and all that other stuff. And now with sponsorships, we see people in commercials, you know, endorsement deals. Now we're starting to see them in actual, you know, bit parts on TV. What was it? Chris Jericho was on one of the Sharknado movies for the Sci-Fi Network.
Edge was on Haven. And then after Christian retired, he brought Christian on board. Edge was great in Haven. He really was.
And you're right.
It depends on what you go into, you know? I mean,
right. And it is
wrestling,
you know,
helps.
Sports entertainment, you know, it is a form of show business. It is is like what Joey Ryan had said, you know, it is a form of theater, you know.
I'll argue somebody down that says that, you know, pro wrestling isn't art. I'll argue with them all day long. It's a ballet. I know we don't say that this isn't ballet, but it's the timing of it all is much like ballet. There's a flow to it. There's, you know, in theater, there's good guys and bad guys and, you know, all kinds of great stuff like that. And this is an art. You have to work on your craft. It's just, you know, just because people get up, eat on one another doesn't make it any less artful than anything else.
Yeah, and you know, I think, like I said, the just the level of opportunity now is, you know, as strong as what it's ever been for someone to diversify and get into other areas and you know, get into, you know, whatever they would like to, you know, and wrestling has provided that platform and has provided that visibility for people to get seen, you know, in certain things. And, you know, look at the amount of spin-off or the amount of shows, you know, E is, you know, you got Total Divas. There's just a whole, you know, plethora of stuff that people can get involved with now versus, you know, several years ago. Like I said, I think that some of the opportunities were a little more limited. Now it seems like it's limitless, you know, based on, you know, partly skill, partly popularity, and, you know, a few other factors. But, yeah, I can see where it can go both ways. You want to go on and give out the social media stuff? Because I know that here, after a bit, after we get done with Luke, we want to have an announcement. I want to make sure everybody has the Twitter address and stuff.
Sure. You can follow along with George One Potato Coles tonight at From the Armory. He is live tweeting. You can also follow along with my adventures at Circle Sky. You can follow around Bob and his misadventures at Bob_Dell. You can follow along with George, the Road Not Taken Coles, at Heel Heat Show. You can also follow along our good friend, Dr. Gooseltron, at The Gray Lobster. And you can find us on Facebook. We've got two pages on Facebook. You can follow along with us at the official Live from the Armory page. And you can also go on there and follow along with the fans of Live from the Armory. Also, we have a YouTube channel. Just search Live from the Armory in the search box on YouTube. Every episode of this show for the last 2 years, which next year I'll have to say three, is on there. So if you know, are out and you're making your towns, you know, you got to have something to listen to. You know, hey, what did Cedric Alexander say about AJ Styles when they first met at PWX, which that came up on my timeline the other day for some, I know what, when we had Cedric and Ariel on last year, or a couple years ago rather, that came up on my timeline.
Yeah.
That's a good memory. If you want to hear Steve Carino talk about the Rock and Roll Express, DDP talking about DDP yoga, Caleb Conley talking about how, Crappy Bob is. There's all kinds of things. You can go on YouTube and listen to some of that, but a lot of it is on FNX on Blog Talk Radio as well. But however you want to listen to us, please do. We have a lot of great interviews with a lot of great independent stars who have gone on to other things. We did one of the first interviews with Tessa Blanchard. And now she's out in California. I saw her on her Instagram. She's at a Lakers game. So, you know, people who are going places start at Life from the Armory. So, but anyway, I wanted to talk about what I had seen this week a little bit, other than Dolph Ziggler. I've decided that I'm going to start calling Zane Dawson Zany Dawson.
Going to call him Zany.
Zany Dawson, because I don't know if he and Dave cheated to get those titles. I don't know, because I haven't seen it. Isaac didn't see it because didn't say anything to me, because she's blind as a bat, because she never sees anybody cheating. It must be in that quick minute that she looks away, is what she tells me. I don't know. I'll have to judge for myself. But if I was a betting person, I would say that they did cheat. Now, if George was involved, I'll say that he assisted, because George South is a national treasure and should be treated as such.
Yeah. Well,
George South
is
a wonderful man.
Yeah, I know. And we can carry on with your Zany parade at a different point in time, because I don't want to keep this guy waiting.
Oh, no, we can't keep Luke waiting. Come on now.
No, it's been like 3 years, and I've been thinking all day about the proper introduction to give this guy. I mean, you know, he is a professional wrestler. He is an entrepreneur. He is a stuntman. He's an all-around good guy. And
he's
the thing
like
that
a brick shit house.
Okay, yeah, here it comes. I think probably the thing that also got me was, you know, watching – his growth in Hollywood. You know, we could call him Hollywood Hawx, but he dies on screen better than anybody else that Laura and I know. And that's just
sure
from
does.
His stuff that he does on TV and film. Folks, we'd like to welcome back to the show our good friend, Mr. Luke Hawx. Luke, how are you, sir?
Yo, what's going on?
Hard times, brother. Hard times.
Yeah. Hey, I want to second what you, I guess second what you said, but you said nobody dies better on screen. There's an old quote from Clint Eastwood. Clint Eastwood said, "Dying ain't much of a living," and outlaw Josie Wales. Well, I beg to differ, you know.
Your pocketbook is different.
The checks are still going in the bank just fine, right?
That's right. Yeah, exactly. I'm cashing them, baby. It's been a minute. What's going on?
Man, it's all good. It's all good. And as you can hear, laughing along with me is my road partner and co-host, Laura. Laura, you want to say hey to Luke?
Oh, you know I love her. So
yeah, I love you too, Luke. It's so great to have you on again because, you know, we see each other at WrestleCade every year, but don't really talk a whole lot. But so excited to have you back on.
How y'all doing? How's that? Thanks for having me. I appreciate it. It's been a minute, man. Bob's been, like, procrastinating about getting me on. You know, he's got so
he
many
has.
More people that's important, more important than me. You know, he, like, you know, he's always a big fan of the flippy floppers, the guys that are doing, like, the gymnastics. So I'm just sitting here taking the back seat.
Yeah, that's me, brother. I'm just hanging out my Will Ospreay jersey, you know, just just getting after it, brother. You know, that's how it rolls. That's how it rolls. You know, we can talk old school because I wanted to talk a little bit of old school with you, or old new school, as it's been coined. This new project that you got going on with Ring Warriors that's currently on WGN.
Yeah, it's awesome. Of course, you know, anything starting out, it has its kinks. So, you know, people are critical about any new product, I guess, that comes out. You know, everybody always has their opinions.
Right.
They want to say – some say positive things, some say negative things. Well, I like this, I don't like this. But the deal with Ring Wars is it's a talented group of individuals and wrestlers from around the world, okay?
Right.
And it's a new platform for them to debut their stuff on. You know, so you might not – look, guys like Chase Stevens, all right? You know Chase Stevens from TNA. Yeah, unless you live in, like, the southern Nashville, all that area where Chase Stevens lives, where he wrestles tremendously a lot, you probably haven't seen him since TNA. So you get to see this guy back on national TV. There's a lot of new faces, man. There's guys like Chris Bay, Shogun Jones, that guys out of the Vegas area that are just really, really, really good hands that haven't had a national TV spotlight yet. And so this is putting it on. You know, it comes on every Saturday at, I think, 8 a.m. nationwide. I believe it's nationwide at 8 a.m. But, I mean, it's in, like, what, 75 million households? Who can beat
right.
that?
You
oh,
can't.
Wow.
You can't beat that. Yeah,
right.
It's a big deal.
And then you have, you know, guys that you know and love, like, well, I hope you don't love them, but Austin Aries, there's Jeff Cobbs, there's Eli Drake, there's myself. So many guys from that have been around for a long time that you've seen from different TV shows or different wrestling organizations, no matter if they're freaking indies or television products, you know. It's just the talent, man. They got a handful of talent on this show.
You had a solid match with Jeff Cobb on this past Saturday's episode, and you did a move, speaking of doing flippy stuff, that I had not seen you do. Or I tried to think back. I don't think I've ever seen anybody do this move. And I think the commentary team couldn't even find a name for it. I think one of them said it was a modified Rana, and I'm like, what the hell is a modified Rana?
Which we're going to have to step away. It's called the Halo. I invented it. I've been doing it since it started. I've been doing it since, you know, 1999. So the only other person I've ever seen do it was a Japanese lady. I forget her name. She tried to do it from the inside out of the ring. And she actually – I've seen her do it and hit it before, and then I've seen her do it where she's landed on her neck on the apron as well. So When I was doing it early on in my career, a few people tried to copy. Like when I was doing it early days of TNA, like Sonny Siaki tried it. He almost broke his neck. And you guys probably remember Sonny Siaki. Maybe not. Nobody probably remembers Sonny Siaki. So, you know, like I've been doing that for 20 years now. And I don't bust it out all the time, but I do it regularly. It's a special move. It's something I'm proud of. And, you know, nowadays it's hard to come up with wrestling moves because so much is done. So that's one I can say I have in my trick bag.
Well, and I'm going to let everybody know, if you missed it, you need to find it on WGN. Ring Warriors comes on nationwide, 75 million households, 8 a.m. on Saturday mornings. Since we're growing,
that,
I know I'm just reinforcing what you said. That's all I'm doing. I'm here to reinforce. Since
Goodbye,
we're
stealing
growing,
my shine, stealing my spot,
not,
man.
No,
he is.
Brother,
he's a spot
no,
stealer.
No.
He is. He's a spot stealer.
I'm not a spot stealer. No, I'm not. Since we're throwing names around, here's another spot for you. Since we're throwing names around, before signing with the WWE, you had challenged AJ Styles numerous times to no avail. Some
right.
say that he ducked you. And I've noticed on
no,
Twitter.
No, not to say that he ducked me. He did. He
did duck you.
He
okay,
backed
we'll
out of several matches. I mean, you've seen they had – The very first match was advertised for over 6 months, and that was in England. You know, it was
right.
the only main event of the show advertised, and, you know, he pulled some political strings and got me taken off the show about a week before the show. You know, I mean, I still got paid for the show.
Right.
But, of course, you know, I was taken off the show because they couldn't afford a flight. But they flew in a ton of Japanese guys. They flew in AJ Styles, everybody else, you know, and our match was the only match promoted for 6 months, the main event.
Right.
So it was built up after I wrestled Finn Balor and he was obviously Prince Devitt then. So I wrestled Prince Devitt, beat him, and the winner of that match was supposed to wrestle AJ Styles. That's where it all started. Well, AJ didn't want to wrestle me, scared to wrestle me. And then, of course, AML had it booked. You talked to Tracy. You talked to Brian. They had that book for a while. AJ backed out of that. So, I mean, it was in several other ones. You know, it's just he's a coward, man. Look, you can't be the best in the world when you're backing out of matches because you're scared to wrestle guys. If you're that intimidated in a wrestling business, get out the business. You know, go do gymnastics.
Well, I've noticed on Twitter that you've challenged current NWA World Champion Cody Rhodes. Do you feel Rhodes is a man of integrity and will answer any of your challenges?
You know what I feel about Cody Rhodes is, you know, I really don't have any issues with Cody. I think he's a talented performer. I love the opportunity to step in the ring with him. But what I do feel with Cody is that he's another one that's kind of baby, you know. He got the spot he's in because of his father, of course. Now, I'm not saying he didn't work hard. I know he's going to say he'll piss and moan about that and complain, oh, you know, that's been said, blah, 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 about proving that. No, you've worked hard. But you initially got that spot because of your last name, not because of how good you were in the ring. You know, I grew up, again, sleeping in my car, chasing wrestling. I can't knock him for that. I can't knock this man for taking an opportunity and getting the ball and running with it. He put his time in,
right.
He paid his dues. He busted his ass and worked his way up the ladder. Now, don't be a cherry picker. You know what I mean? Don't just be able to wrestle the top guys that are on TV, because there's a lot of top guys that are phenomenal wrestlers that haven't been on that really national exposure like myself. You know, I'm not going to sell myself short here, but I haven't had all the opportunities I should have. People, because I intimidate people because I'm not scared to say what's on my mind. I'm not the yes man. I don't go around kissing tail trying to get a match and trying to book this and trying to, hey, man, will you book me here? I'll book you. And, you know, I don't do that stuff. You know, I go out there, I wrestle my ass off, and I put my feelings into what I do. So that bothers some people because it intimidates people. If I don't like somebody, you know, I say it. People, and look, I have to have a big reason to not like you. You know what I mean? Like, I don't just dislike anybody. But let's be honest. Some guys that are in spots are jerks. And they're only in spots because their friend's booking or this. Is, you know how it is. It's the business. So it's politics. I've never been a political guy. I've been a straightforward guy my whole life. So, and I think Cody's around working the ROH guys, working the New Japan guys. How about step out the box a little bit? How about take somebody who's going to push you a little bit and also push myself? It gives me something to work towards. You know, why am I not getting a shot at Ring of Honor? Why is Ring of Honor not beating down my door? It's not because of talent. Okay, we could all agree on that, and some could disagree. To each his own. Everybody's got their opinion on who Luke Hawx is, but I know how good I am. I know what I'm capable of. Why is Ring of Honor not making it happen? Why is Ring of Honor not giving me an opportunity? You know, I just worked the show with my son, WrestleMania week. Well, we tagged. against Motor City Machine Guns and Bruiser and Malonis. So why am I not getting more opportunities from Ring of Honor?
That's why I call you the top guy killer. That's why I call you the top guy killer. They don't want you coming in and ruining their top guys.
Yeah, I mean, maybe that's what it is. Because I don't have the TV face. But here's the thing. Because I wasn't on WWE TV for 5 or 10 years, I'm doing everything else. I'm doing everything else but WWE. So, and I work a lot with WWE. I have a good relationship with them. So I'm not knocking that. But tell me another indie guy who's doing what I'm doing. I'm running the top company in the South. We have a phenomenal training center. We got great students coming out all the time. We got Wildkat Sports, right? You turn on your TV. Last week alone, I had small appearances, and I say small because they were just cameos. I didn't even know I was going to be on Total Divas, all right? We were just out hanging with some friends, and all of a sudden they start rolling with the cameras. Next thing you know, we're on Total Divas. So I'm on Total Divas on E, all right? I had a little small stunt on The Purge last week, which is on USA.
Oh, my.
But then Ring Warriors on Saturday night. So in the same week, I'm on 3 national television shows, some international. So, and then you go to the movies. You see me in top movies. I'm always in something. Like you said, I'm always getting killed on screen. That's what I do. I'm a stuntman and an actor. So, I mean, look at it. Look at what I'm doing now. Tell me another guy who's doing what I'm doing.
I can't.
No, you can't. And I'm not knocking other people. There's a hell of a lot of talented guys out there. But why am I getting passed over and those certain companies for wrestling? Why are they scared? Why won't they give me the opportunity? I call them out. Let's go. Let's do it. I'm ready.
You heard you, Mr. Coles.
That's the question.
Get it out on Twitter. We're ready. You know, you mentioned PJ, your son, and he's made his professional wrestling debut, has already had the opportunity to travel overseas to wrestle. What advice did you give him about the professional wrestling business, Luke, not only as a wrestler, but as a father?
The thing about my son with wrestling, it's different because me and my son are two different animals, and I don't want, so to speak, my name to be on my son, because I'm a different animal. I approach things a different way. I grew up rough, you know. I've always had this. I said this yesterday in a post. I had this chip on my shoulder, which I still have because I haven't fulfilled. I just grew up rough, you know. It was the lifestyle. I always grew up fighting. I had to fight for everything. Nothing was handed to me. And so I'm a go-getter. I go after things. My son is very humble. My son's way more talented than me. You know, but he had that upbringing. We raised him to be an athlete. We raised him, you know, he's always a straight-A student, always in all honors, you know, bilingual. He was the homecoming king. He was the captain of the wrestling team. He's a state champion in amateur wrestling, Greco and freestyle wrestling. You know, like I didn't have an opportunity to do any of that stuff. But, you know, at 19 years old, he went over to England and wrestled 40 matches in 4 weeks. Wrestled for Ring of Honor. He's wrestled for WWE already. He's done these things very early on in his career, and he's ready to do it. There's still things. He's still got to grow. I mean, he's only 19 years old, but he's still got to go. You know, he's still got to grow. He's going to actually get bigger, get tall. I mean, he's 6'1", about 175 pounds right now. So, but he's 19 years old. So, you know, so me and him are completely different people. If you talk to me and talk to him, you'll see that me and my son are night and day different. We're a lot alike in a lot of ways as far as mannerisms and walking around and ring moves and stuff like that. But my son's just a sweet kid. So I had to tell him that, you know, I don't want people to take advantage of you because you're so innocent and so sweet. You know, my son never got in trouble. He never got a behavior report in school. Now, I was always in the principal's office. So it was, but you know, that's part of upbringing. That's part of upbringing. So I don't want wrestling to ruin my son. I think he's smart enough that he won't let anything negative get to him, and he's never surrounded himself around negativity. But, you know, I keep my business separate from him. Everything I ever did in my life was always, you know, separate. If I was in stuff, I'd never involve my kid. You know, I didn't want him to see a certain side of me. I never wanted him to see me, you know, if I had an incident with somebody like AJ or somebody like that, you know, I didn't want that to involve him. I wanted him to be his own man and walk on his own 2 feet. Now, I, you know, again, like the so we talked about with Cody Rhodes, I also don't want my son to have the struggles I had. I don't want my son to have to drive across country and sleep in his car to get bookings and, you know, chase training like that. If I can provide better opportunities for him, I want to, but I want him to appreciate it and work hard, in which he already does, because his goal was always to be better than me. He had a chip on his shoulder that I literally probably found it out about a year and a half ago. Like, when we were having some troubles, he was turning into a man, and we were just having some troubles, and we were bucking, and he was bucking against me a lot. And, you know, I said, well, what's the problem? And he came and opened up to me, and, you know, he never did this before. Like, he never really opened up this much to me. He said, when you and Mom split up, it really hurt me, and then when you was going so much you were going so much that it hurt.
Right.
So, and that's real. This is real talk. So I never had that like conversation with my son until he got older. But he goes, I do understand now why you had to leave so much, because you were chasing this. As he got more involved in it, you know, he's like,
right,
you were trying to feed me and you were trying to do this and take care of me. And he's like, so I understand why you were, you know, living in Philadelphia for 8 months, like when I was training to go on Wrestling Society X in 2006, things of that nature. Like certain things in the wrestling business that you don't necessarily see from the backstage hand of things. You know, you just see what's put out on the internet, or you just see what's put out on TV, but you don't really know the real life backstories. Like when I was going to Wrestling Society X, they had no training facilities in the Louisiana area. They had no rings, no nothing for me to go into. So I had to move to Philadelphia, where I could wrestle 2 or 3 times a week and make some money and train, so I can be ready to go on TV and shoot these TV shows. So that's what I had to do. So, you know, and it sucks. It sucks. So I don't want to cry a river to anybody, but it's hard for a family man. And it's hard for someone who loves the kids or the kids that love them. But I'm fortunate enough that he's following in my footsteps, and he understands now why I had to do certain things like that. You know, and I hope he never has to. You know, of course there's going to be things that if he ever has a family, there's going to be things he's going to miss because he's going to be on the road and so forth. But I don't want him to go through the same struggles I went through.
Have you arrived at a balance, Luke, between family, wrestling, Hollywood, other interests?
Far from it, man. Okay. I mean, I got a routine, but it's rough for me because it always changes. You know, the film business is kind of on the spot. It's never like where I know I'm going to go shoot something for 4 weeks, or I do this or I do that. It's always like, hey, this week, hey, we're shooting next week and we need you for these days. You know, and so if you had something planned those days, you got to cancel it. Or you have to miss out on filming. So it's which one. I told the story often where, you know, I was booked at WWE just the extra spots, which are, you know, they pay $250 a spot, but it's your chance to go work for the company and get out in front of them and see. So years ago, I had booked a film for 4 weeks, and it was during my WWE days. So 4 weeks is an extreme amount of money on a film, but I already had WWE booked, right? And I told the films that I couldn't do those 4 weeks because I had to miss 2 days. And you can't miss any days because, you know, it's continuity, all that stuff. So I couldn't. So they said, well, if you can't do those 2 dates, then we have to pass on you. And I didn't want to cancel it. My dumb self went to WWE when I could have made freaking 50 times more, you know, being in a film for four weeks and having a good role on a film. It was G.I. Joe 2, which I eventually did a couple weeks on it anyway on another part, but I would have had a bigger role on it if I would have, you know, canceled my WWE shows. So people don't see that side of things. You know what I mean? That's how much I love wrestling, and that's how much I went after it. It's tough, man, because I put my life into this business, and I'm still putting my life into it. I go after it. I just chase it. For Cody Rhodes' example, I want to wrestle Cody Rhodes. I want a piece of Cody Rhodes. I want my opportunity. You know, there's no reason for me to get neglected on that. You know, Joe Blow has been in the business for 2 years trying to make a name for myself. You know, I have proved what I can do. I've been in top companies. I do all these amazing things, magazines, TVs, you know, film. But just you name it, man. I've done it. So I want that opportunity. Give it to me. Why are you going to neglect me out of it because I'm not a ROH or New Japan guy? Well, make it happen in New Japan. Make it happen in ROH. Let's go.
You mentioned a town that we're all familiar with in Philadelphia when you were talking about Wrestling Society X. And this past year, Wildkat Sports has branched out in the state of Louisiana, as well as went to the city of brotherly love in Philadelphia. What was the catalyst?
That was our second year.
What was the catalyst behind trying to move or trying to put on shows, Wildkat shows in Philly?
Well, I mean, we want to expand, obviously. We don't want to be in the same place our whole life. And nothing wrong with New Orleans. We'll always run here. It'll always be our hometown. But our goal is to become larger as a company, not to just stay stagnant. So, you know, we've ran Mississippi. We've ran San Diego. We've ran the border towns in Mexico. We've ran Philadelphia. We've ran where else have we ran? We've ran somewhere else. I'm trying to think. I don't know, but it's too much to keep up with. But we've run multiple shows in multiple states. So right. Our goal is always to grow. And Philadelphia, of course, is a wrestling city. Almost too much wrestling, if there's such a thing. There's a bigger fan base there. I mean, you think a ticket in Louisiana costs about $15 for a general admission ticket, okay, on average. Now, you look back in the 80s, you know, and you look at those old posters in the 80s, tickets were about that price then. So, as far as money's concerned, the money's not really in Louisiana. And ticket prices, you can see, when you see a ticket price in 1980 going for $15 for general admission, and you see a price in 2018 going for $15, I mean, look at that. Now, a general admission ticket in Philadelphia costs $25-$30 for an indie show. You know, front row indie shows out there sell for like over $100. So, we have to outbreak this Louisiana cycle, and we have to go into bigger markets if we want to succeed. And, you know, we're still in the process of doing that. So I'm branching out, man. We just ran Baton Rouge a couple months ago, which was an hour away, but it's the first time we ran Baton Rouge. You know, we chose to run out of state before we ran a couple hours closer to us. And we've always done pretty well. We took a little bit of a hit the last Philly show. The first Philly show did well. A lot of people asked for us to come back, a ton of people. You know, we took a little bit of a hit. We didn't do well on the second Philly show for some reason. And it could be just because, you know, Philly's burnt out, man. I mean, I know House of Hardcore wasn't doing too well out there. Every now and then they'll have a show that just doesn't do well. So you take it with a grain of salt, but that's the wrestling business. You know, not every company sells out every show they do. So you go back to the drawing board and you figure out how you do it better and how you put more asses in seats.
Makes sense to me. Laura, go ahead.
Luke, I just want to say that one of the funniest promos ever, and it's not you being funny, it's the look on Bob's face at the first WrestleCade Bob went to. We got you, and we were getting you to do this promo, and you look straight in the camera, and Papa Burden says, fuck AJ Styles.
Oh, boy.
Y'all say that stuff on here, I forget y'all.
Yeah, I still got it.
Yep.
I have to dig it out and put it up again.
Yeah.
Oh, boy.
Hey, that was me speaking my heart, man.
It sure was.
Yeah, no
my heart.
No shit.
So, like I said, I've never been afraid to hold my tongue, you know, and, you know, some people don't like that. Oh, well.
Well, you know, I would much rather someone be honest and upfront, you know.
That's what I was going to say. I'll never lie to you. I'll never lie to you. You know, that's the one thing I'll never do is lie to you. So, but people don't like that. People want to be told what they want to hear. They necessarily don't like the truth all the time. And I'm not saying I'm always right because I'm wrong in some instances, you know. But if I'm wrong, teach me why I'm wrong and tell me why I'm wrong. Tell me and teach me. I'm here to learn.
And I think that serves you well, too, is that you're like, I am still learning in this business. I'm learning every day.
Every day.
And that's how I'm going to get better.
Every day, man. I'm always trying to get better. And what I do is I pass on the knowledge. You know, you can't teach something you don't know, so I'm always trying to learn.
That's a great way to be in life in general. And just that promo was just so incredibly funny because Bob is like, holy shit, what do I do?
Well, it's not a promo. It was straight from the heart. So
right.
It can't be considered a promo.
It was a little bit of a promo for our show. So, but
it was,
but, you know,
it was an advertisement.
Right.
That's right. That's right. Here's my feelings. Here you go.
Yeah.
Take them.
Absolutely incredible. You know, you had a great feud with Matt Hardy. before the broken gimmick, and now he's, you know, getting ready, or actually he is, you know, retiring. So just a couple of thoughts on Matt Hardy and the incredible matches that you guys had there for about, what, it was like a 6-8 month span?
Oh, it was almost 2 years.
Matches?
We took it all around.
2 years, okay.
Yeah, we took that. It's about a year and a half, so we took that everywhere, man. It was and Matt, I got a lot of respect for Matt because he was one of the first people to really give me that platform and that opportunity. You know, he's such a big star that he could have told me to go F myself. You know,
right.
He could ignore me like some of the other guys do, but he didn't. And, you know, and we ran off real life things. We were wrestling in a match. Matt was wrestling Shane Douglas. And I did a run in and I pushed Matt. And Matt, for whatever reason, pancaked out and smacked his head on the floor.
Oh,
so that was real life. He got knocked out into concussed. He was having convulsions, throwing up. He had to be rushed to the emergency room. It took about 45 minutes for the ambulance to get there. I mean, it was a bad situation. It was really a bad situation. A freak accident. He hit his head on the floor. But that sparked a real life feud. It sparked real life interest. It sparked where Rebby was mad at me. So she went online and she started bad mouthing me right away that night. You know, and I went back and forth with her, and that just that brought in so much attention, which drew into this Hardy Hawx feud, and we took it all around. And then we beat the hell out of each other, and I appreciate that because I was always buddies with Matt before. Matt was one of the really nice guys that was nice to me coming up in the business, and always, like, you know, looked out for me and always would give me advice. So I really appreciated that. And then when we started having that feud, it just took it to a whole new level because we went all out. And, you know, Matt had been around the world and back 20 times already at that point in his career, and he made me step my game up. He made me become a better wrestler. He gave me that opportunity. So I'll always be thankful for him for that. And he's just a good man. He's a good family man. He's a good friend, a good person. You know, I wish wrestling had more people like that in it, because unfortunately there's a lot of scumbags in wrestling. A lot of people who are just in it for themselves and very stingy, and, you know, they hurt people and they'll steal from you. So it's just, you know, I hate being around people like that.
I can't say that I blame you at all. Wrestling's a tough sport in a lot of ways, and I'm not even in it.
I'm at my training center right now, so I want to yell something into the guys.
You go right ahead.
Hey, you guys work on some chain until I'm done with this. Teach them some. Slow it down and just teach them some stuff. Oh, sorry about that.
That's okay.
Okay.
You got to do what you got to do.
Tonight's an extra night. We usually don't train on Tuesdays. On Wednesdays at Wildkat. So tonight's an extra night. We got some guys in the ring working on some chain with some new guys.
Hey,
cool.
You know, you got to take the opportunities and advantages when you got them.
Exactly.
You know, you mentioned Shane Douglas. You've got this match coming up with him on October the 6th in Metairie, Louisiana. It's a New Orleans street fight. Let's talk about that match.
Let's talk
about
it. Shane Douglas, we'll go back to the AJ Styles thing. Shane Douglas is the first person to, so to speak, ignore me in wrestling and refuse to wrestle me. You know, Shane was my hero growing up. When I got tuned into ECW in my later teenage years, it just took over my life. It influenced everything I did, and I had never seen a guy like Shane Douglas before, from his ring work to his mic skills. So I was like, I just took to Shane, and I took to ECW in general, but Shane was the one who stood out the most to me. So I met him, and I started working for him in XPW, and I found out that Shane wasn't who I thought he was. And he was a scumbag. So, and at the point in his life, he was, you know, he was a pill head. He was hooked on pills. He treated people like shit. He was out for himself. He didn't care about anybody. So I went from looking up to this guy and idolizing this guy and thinking this guy was all about the business and all about underdogs and people like me who fight from the bottom, that, you know, I bought into his gimmick because his gimmick was real to me. It's something I could relate to. And when I worked with him, I just found that, like, he was a piece of shit. And it crushed me. And, you know, I was 145, 160 pounds at the most, okay? Now, instead of encouraging a guy like me, hey, you need to get in the gym, you need to do this, you need to do that. Well, I'm a truthful person. I'm a blunt person. People do not like that, but that's just me. I tell guys, hey, you need to work on this. Hey, get in the gym. Hey, you're too small. Hey, you're too fat. Hey, you this, you that. What I think I see in these people, and I'll say what I think I see, I tell them. Now, back then, nobody was telling me that. Nobody was telling me to get in the gym. Nobody was telling me to work on this, to work on that. It was just like, no, you don't have a shot. And also back then, people were so afraid of losing their spots, or so afraid of people stealing. That's what I heard so much coming into the business. You know, oh, such and such is going to screw you over because, you know, they don't. You're gunning for their spot. You're gunning for their spot. That was so common when I was coming up in wrestling early on. That I guess I was part of that era. You know what I mean? It was that era. So instead of trying to help me grow as a performer and trying to tell me what I need to do to get better, I was just like buried. Hey, no, you suck. Hey, you're not going to make it. Hey, you know, instead, like I said, tell me to go to the gym. Don't tell me I don't have a shot. Don't tell me I can't do something. Tell me what I need to do to fix it. And nobody was offering that info. And that was with Shane. And so I carried that. I carried that, man, for years. And I didn't say anything about it. And I bit my tongue and I sat back and I held it in. And I was just so let down by the person who I looked up to the most in wrestling coming up. And, you know, he has, like I said, he has such a big influence on me. I kept that. And for years, I eventually just said, you know what? I can't stand him. And I'm going to be vocal about it. I'm not going to bite my tongue anymore. I don't care who sees it, who doesn't like it, who doesn't this. So I started putting out the promos. That was just me putting out my promos about him. And that one company that failed in Philly that had so much potential, which I'm not even going to name because it's not worth a name because the guy ended up ripping so many people off, but it had so much potential at first, they contacted me and said, hey, we would need to run with this. Shane did not want to do it. They had five owners. Two of them were good, and then the other three were turds. I mean, Shane being one of them, and the other guy, the other two guys, oh, my God. So, yeah. So the two guys who wanted to run with it, I was cool with, and I was like, let's run with it. So Shane didn't want to do it. It was back and forth, and, you know, it turned into, like, Shane would eventually hire personal security in the locker room so I couldn't be around him. And then one day we finally had a confrontation, and, I mean, it was me, him, and Stevie Richards, and, I mean, it got ugly. So it was just, I told him how I finally got to just get off my chest how I felt about him and what he did to me and how he treated me. And, you know, it was just, he would not admit it, though. He wouldn't admit it. So, like, we never worked the program. The company failed almost, you know, it was around for a little bit, but the company failed because they were taking the money that they were making off shows and they were blowing it. So they blew it on a bunch of BS, and then they were trying to pay for one show by promoting the next show and selling tickets to the next show. After the first gate drew the biggest gate in probably independent history, it drew over a six-figure gate with over 2,000 fans. You know, and they made so much money on that show, they thought it was just going to keep pouring in, so they went and blew it. They blew it all. So, you know, just terrible business. But, you know, that feud never happened, and Shane really didn't want to work it anyway, and he was kind of being forced and ducking and dodging his way out of it. So years later, for some reason, he stepped up. He stepped up. He said he would wrestle me. And that just came from people saying, hey, you know, you should have wrestled Luke. You should have wrestled Luke. And then I guess he heard it one too many times, and he said, F it, I'm going to wrestle Luke now. So we had the first match in Philly, and here we are going to our second match in New Orleans, Louisiana, where the feud, you know, really, it didn't start here, but this is where he had the first attack on me here in front of my hometown fans, where he stepped up to the plate and said he was going to play ball. You know, and he put in his effort to do what he could to kick me while I was down. So come the Saturday night, it's Hawx versus Douglas 2 in New Orleans street fight. Anything goes. You know, of course, it's sold out already. General Mission it's hot. I mean, we will have 1,500 people in that place. The place will be rocking and rolling. It'll be packed, and it'll be loud. So you're coming into my backyard. You know, you're stepping into the danger zone, so to speak. So this ain't Philadelphia,
exactly.
Pennsylvania, where this ain't the house you built. This is the house I built. So I'm ready. You know, I've been looking forward to this for, I can say well over 20 years, because it was always my dream as a kid to step into the ring with Shane Douglas, but I have a different outlook on it now. He's no longer my hero. He's no longer iconic to me. You know what I mean? He's just another guy who held me down on the way to pursuing my dreams. So you're stepping in with a different Luke Hawx. You're stepping in with a different animal. And he's not the Shane Douglas as old, you know, as well.
Right.
You know, he's not
exactly.
Shane Douglas from ECW. He's a different Shane Douglas. So I got news. It's going to be bad for him.
I don't doubt it one bit. I would bet the farm on it. I got two more questions for you, Luke. One,
all right.
One is, so what is the right way to hang toilet paper?
Oh, it's over. It's always over.
Never
anybody
under.
Who puts the toilet paper roll under is just, look, we got no use in life for them. And here's the other thing. It's 2018. Who uses toilet paper anyway? You got to have it there for safety, but wet wipes are the way to go.
Exactly.
We also did a whole
Thank
podcast
you.
On wet wipes.
Thank you. Thank you. Splurge on the wet wipes. That's
ooh-wee.
For sure. And one more thing. I just want to say, you know, to people that don't think that, you know, you look like you're, you know, TV worthy or WWE worthy or whatever worthy to be on TV, you are, trust me. There's a lot of people, and I'm one of them, that would agree that you most certainly are very easy on the eyes. So I just want to throw that
easy
out.
On here.
Thank
comes.
You, thank you.
Easy on the eyes,
but I'm a,
yes.
But I'm a better wrestler. And here the thing is, when you watch Ring Warriors, you see that. You see who's TV
exactly.
worthy or not. And, you know,
exactly.
I, like I said, I don't want to sell myself short, but, you know, part of the issue is I'm not a golden boy. I'm not in golden boy territory. So I'm not in Northeast. I'm not in L.A., so I don't get the eyes that, you know, these guys from
right.
where we don't have the news reporters down here reporting about every Wildkat show and how great this guy and how great that guy is. So a lot of times we get overlooked. And it's been like that my whole career. You know, when I went to Philly, I was getting eyes on me. When I went to L.A., I was getting eyes on me. Things were blowing up. But, like, nobody, you know, we have a great thing here at Wildkat Sports. Well, we packed the house with fans. We got a great television show which draws great ratings. You know, we do so many great things here, but we don't have any internet reporters here. So nobody puts it out. So we kind of get overlooked on that internet aspect, which is big in wrestling nowadays. That kind of we do. We get overlooked. The only guy who really reports about us regularly is Mike Johnson from PWInsider.com, and I really appreciate that because Mike always goes out of his way to get reports from our show or have somebody, you know, post something about our show up. So, you know, Mike always sends us love, which I appreciate because he's a fan of our product. I wish more internet sites would do the same.
Makes sense.
Well, George Cole,
makes
let's
sense.
Get that out here on the Twitter machine. We got to get more internet sites looking at Wildkat. Come on.
That's right.
Chop, chop.
That's right. At wildcatsports.com. You know what I mean? Wildcatwrestling.com, wildcatsports.com. Or you can Instagram, Twitter, Facebook, everything's at Wildkat Sports, WILDKAT. Check it out.
Luke, I got one last thing for you. George, who's been running Twitter tonight, he had a question because he's a huge ECW fan from back in the day as well as I am. And, you know, all the talk about Shane Douglas, and you've had the opportunity to wrestle at the, now they call it the 2300 Club or 2300 Arena, but it'll always be the
right.
It'll always be the ECW Arena to us. Special feeling getting to wrestle in that building?
Man, it's my favorite building. It's actually one of my favorite buildings. It might be my favorite building ever. But, I mean, influential-wise, definitely my favorite building. It was not Madison Square Garden or anything else like that. But I've been fortunate enough to wrestle in a lot of great buildings like the Cow Palace, which was awesome, the L.A. Sports Auditorium, the Grand Olympic Auditorium in L.A. But, I mean, the ECW Arena is just special. And I performed there. I've had many magical moments there. I've wrestled Shane there. I wrestled Matt Hardy in the cage. When the arena closed down for those years, when they first opened back up, we were the first show to run there, and I main evented the first wrestling show back there against Matt Hardy in the cage. My first title at the ECW. Yeah, I won my first title at the ECW arena in 2002 when I won the XPW King of Deathmatch title. The owner texted me not too long ago, and there's a mural painting of, I guess it's a mural. I'm probably wrong with that, but it's my name. I don't know what that, but they got a poster painted on the wall, and my name is real big on it, Luke Hawx. And he thought that was, he said, hey, I think you should see this. I know you would appreciate it. And he goes, we painted this on the wall. Thank you. So I was like, you know, to have my name up on the wall there.
That's awesome.
But now that's going to bother me because a mural is a picture of a person. What would we call that?
A mural?
Of a picture of a person. Now, what would just my name be painted on the wall? What is that called? What is it?
That's a good question.
Because it's from a flyer. It's from like a wrestling show flyer there. Like they painted it real big, which is, it's cool, man. But you know what I mean? So my name is on the wall in, you know, the most influential wrestling building I've ever seen. Something I grew up in. So it got to perform there. So it's magical for me, man. There's nothing can take that away from me. It's an accomplishment I had, you know, and then now my son's wrestled there, which is even cooler. You know, my son, when we went there and ran the Wildkat shows there, my son got to wrestle his like seventh or eighth match was there. So his fifth match was in front of 7,000 people at Ring of Honor at their biggest show ever when they did the WrestleMania weekend here. So, you know, like early on in his career, and he's good. He's really good. So early on in his career, he got to do these amazing things. So that I worked a long time to get to do. So I'm thankful, man. Very thankful.
Because I'm a spot stealer, the 7-year anniversary of the Revolution Rumble is this Saturday, October 6th at the Meisler Middle School in Metairie, Louisiana. Make sure you go to Wildkat Wrestling or wildcatwrestling.com. Yeah, doors open at 6, bell times at 7. Tickets start at $15. Luke.
That's right, general admission.
Yep.
Thank you. Check us out. Check out all our social media. If you want to check me out on social media, you can look at me on Instagram and Twitter at LukeHawx504. That's HAWX at LukeHawx504. I'm always vocal. I'm always loud, and I post a lot of gym pictures and videos. So, and
none of that,
of course, my friends.
Yeah.
But come out this Saturday night. Check out WildkatWrestling.com. Check us out on social media. It's at Wildkat Sports. You know, everything's at Wildkat Sports. Excuse me. And just appreciate y'all having me on, man. Thank you for giving me my time. Cody Rhodes, where you at? I'm gunning for you.
Thank you, Luke. Appreciate
you,
brother.
See you at WrestleCade, Luke.
Well, I'm sorry, what did you say?
See you at WrestleCade.
I don't know about WrestleCade. I haven't been booked for WrestleCade, so y'all better call Tracy and Brian and see what's up with that.
We'll put in the call right now.
We don't want to miss this year, but we have nothing from them so far, so. Hopefully they hit me up and we get out there because we always love being a part of WrestleCade.
Yeah, love seeing you guys.
Let's go. Right, and I had one of the best matches in WrestleCade history with the cage match with Gunner a few years back.
That's true.
Yeah,
here's the thing. Is the last few years, everything from WrestleCade, I've always got screwed out of. You know, we were going to do the AJ Styles thing there. That never happened. Then I was supposed to wrestle EC3 and he backed out of that match. The day of the show, I ended up wrestling BJ Whitmer on the wing. Last show, I did Tommy Dreamer. Why can't I think of his name? I know him well. Big bearded guy. Really good wrestler. Ah, Jesus.
Who?
I'm trying to point out.
No. I wrestled Gunner in the cage before that. He was an AML heavyweight champion. He's really good.
Zane.
He's a big guy.
Zane Dawson.
I had a brain fart. But, I mean, Zane Dawson. I got to wrestle him and Tommy Dreamer in a three-way, and that was fun. So,
that's right.
Let's go. I really like to come into WrestleCade this year and wrestle with my son in a tag match. I mean, it would be great to wrestle, like, Billy Gunn and his son. You know, a father-son versus father-son tag match. You know, because Austin Sopp's down here. Austin Gunn's down here. He's wrestling this weekend. And they were in a four-way dance. It's my son, PJ Hawx, Austin Gunn, Sway Thompson, and Fidel Bravo from California. Both ones from Vegas, ones from California. But how cool would that be to have Billy Gunn and Austin Gunn versus Luke Hawx and PJ Hawx?
Pretty cool. Kind of right itself.
We're going to have to put Doug in Tracy's ear.
That's right. Get in his ear. Let him know.
We'll do.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Bye, y'all need anything, give me a shout. Y'all have a good day.
Certainly.
Good night.
You too.
Bye,
take care.
Bye. Bye now. There goes Luke Hawx, and we'll be back as we catch our breath right after this brief message.
Hey, everyone. Lovely Laura asking you, when you think of wrestling snacks, what comes to mind? Hot dogs? Popcorn? What about you, Bob?
Oh, some escargot, oysters Rockefeller, maybe a nice quiche.
You look like a quiche.
Seriously, folks, if you're looking for an awesome treat or a wrestling-inspired gift endorsed by both wrestlers and wrestling fans alike, look no further than Turnbuckle Cupcakes.
You can find Brandy and Julianne on their Turnbuckle Cupcakes Facebook page or visit them at www.turnbucklecupcakes.storeenvy.com.
Always cool to be able to have a good friend like Luke Hawx on the show. He is one of the stand-up guys in
he
the wrestling
is.
Business. He is never short on words. He is 100% honest, and he will tell you like it is. He will tell you like it is, and you know, I'm not saying anything that he wouldn't say on air. So I'm going to go on. I'll tell this little story, and then we'll move on to some other stuff. A couple years ago, I'm talking with Luke, and we're in a lobby, a hotel lobby, and Shane Douglas walks past, and of course, I have a mark out moment, and I said, "Look, Luke, it's Shane Douglas." And he turned to me and he said, "Bob, he's a piece of shit." And I said, "Okay." So if you're wanting to know if it gets any more real than that, if you thought that, you know, what we were talking about, you know, beforehand was some kind of an angle or a work.
With play, it ain't.
My hand to God. Those were the exact words that came out of his mouth. Bob, he's a piece of shit. So that's a true story. So I wanted to make sure that everybody knew that, you know, he's 100% legit when he talks about that. I got the chance to see two of those matches in that series with Luke and Matt Hardy when they were wrestling, and you can dig back up through YouTube and find these. Of course, I think the big match happened in Philly at the ECW arena when he faced Hardy in the cage. That's when he did that off the top of the cage blockbuster in the ECW arena, and the place just went freaking nuts. I mean, it was pretty,
I'm sure,
pretty wild, but awesome guy, awesome individual. And has always been nothing but a stand-up guy, quality individual, and certainly wish Luke nothing but the best in wrestling and Hollywood and all points in between. So was really glad that we were able to go
Me
back
too.
And visit with him. You know, it's been too long. It did 3 years. I don't know where the time even goes. Not even sure where it goes.
Seriously, you know, it's just, and here we are, you know, at WrestleCade. On the, you know, cusp of the road to WrestleCade, which starts, you know, in November, and I'm so excited. I got to sit down and make my list. I got to plan out, you know, who I'm going to meet, and, you know, there's a lot of great people coming to WrestleCade that I've not met. You know, I got, you know, IRS. I got that calendar with Mike Rotunda in it. I got to get that autograph. Like to meet Edge again. You know, there's just so many people, and, you know, it's like a family reunion, too, because I get to see you and Boy Band and Chris Riddle. He's coming. He is coming.
Good.
And so, you know, we'll get to see our good friend Michelle Isaac, who's listening tonight, who doesn't seem to think she's blind as a bat, but she is. And we'll get to see Big Donnie, of course. Love seeing Big Donnie at WrestleCade. I will tell this. This is one of the funniest things that ever happened to me. Two of the funniest things. I didn't really know Big Donnie the first time that he came to WrestleCade. I had an extra ticket. the man I was dating at the time, we broke up, and so I had an extra ticket. We were going to go to WrestleCade together. I had an extra ticket, and I put it out on Facebook, hey, I got this extra ticket for WrestleCade. This is how much it cost me. It's all I want. So Big Donnie's like, hey, I'll take that. And I'm like, okay. So he shows up at WrestleCade. We're sitting talking and everything, and we're going down the convention center, down that little ramp there. And they usually, the middle ramp is not where people, the middle of the ramp with the two stair rails, on the rails, rather, on the sides. In the middle, you don't normally go down that way because the lines are on either side. And I'm looking, and we're walking down the middle of this thing. There's nobody else, and everybody else is on the in the lines, and they're looking at us. And I'm like, Donnie, I don't think we're supposed to be here. He looks around, looks at me, and says, you think anybody's going to tell me I ain't supposed to be here? No, I don't. Not at all. I do not. I do not. So
that sounds like Donnie.
So we're sitting. I did not know Tracy Myers at this time, like we do now. So Donnie and I are sitting behind the Frank Myers Automax table, which is the car dealership that Tracy owns. And this at time at WrestleCade was right after the whole F Gunner thing with the $5 wrestling thing. So Gunner comes out, and I don't know if somebody did this on purpose, but somehow – when they had his little montage when he came out, there was a five in the background. I don't know if somebody did that on purpose or whatever. So we're sitting there, and all of a sudden Donnie starts singing, fuck Gunner, fuck Gunner. And he doesn't care. He doesn't care who hears him. And like I said, I did not know Tracy at this time, like we do now. But it was the most hilarious thing ever. Just Donnie, fuck Gunner. Fuck. I'm like, Donnie, what are you doing? You're going to get us in trouble.
Oh, my gosh.
But if you miss WrestleCade, those are the kind of moments you'll miss out on. Great moments, you know, hanging out with me and Bob and John and boy band. And also, you know, there's wrestling there, too. You know, whatever.
Yeah. That's like the side attraction.
Yeah, you know. But seriously, I'm looking forward to it. Still got some great names being announced like every day. It's like, holy crap. And, you know, George, getting off the subject of the FCP a little bit, George is kind of BFF with old Cody Rhodes, isn't he?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, he is.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Like his boy.
And yeah. So maybe we could get old BFF Coles there to, you know, kind of drop a little bug in Cody's ear to give Luke Hawx a chance, an opportunity at the NWA title. Bring the title down to Wildkat. What a boost
That would be an interesting proposition. I hope that Mr. Coles has been diligent on Twitter tonight and putting and going at people, and I mean at like the at sign. Not just typing away. I want you to get those out to the people that need to get it out to, George. Don't duck and dodge now. Don't duck and dodge now. I just put out on Twitter, it was announced a while back, but because it's a countdown, but I put out the information Ohio Valley Wrestling is celebrating its 1,000th TV taping.
Yeah,
and I caught wind of that. I caught wind of that from former show guest Randy Royal, who had
posted some great stuff.
Yeah, some old pictures of stuff that's happened throughout taping. So wanted to put that out. If you're in the Louisville area, you probably want to check that out. That's probably going to be a big deal of a show. And, you know, 1,000, you know, what could be better than 1,000 other than 2,000? OVW continues to put out a quality product every week. So if you're in the Louisville area, you want to make sure that you check that out. Wanted to mention, I know that you saw this and I saw it too. We've been talking about Cody Rhodes all night. Cody Rhodes, you know, speaking of using that Rhodes name, put out a pretty good promo on Juice Robinson at the New Japan Pro Wrestling Fighting Spirit show. Funding to Juice using the American Dream moniker, and Juice kind of backpedaled a little bit, said, I didn't mean American Dream as in Dusty. I meant American Dream as in, this is the version that I'm living. But it was a fired up Cody Rhodes that seemed to grab everybody's attention by mentioning Dusty and NXT and calling NXT trainees Dusty's kids. So have to see where this line of goes with Dusty or Cody and Juice. I apologize. Pretty interesting stuff. It was pretty heated. So I wanted to make sure that we mentioned that. And I'm on the Twitter machine now, and something that we've been working on, and we'll put this out on Twitter, and we'll also put it up on Facebook later. Wanted to go on and give everybody a sneak peek at the new design of a new t-shirt that we've got coming out. And if you're interested in this shirt, give us a little like, send us a message, let us know what you think about it, your thoughts. It will be out. We're giving it a trial run. See what kind of interest goes on. We might even only do a limited run of these. So we haven't fully discussed it, but I'm going to put it out anyway. You can take a look at it, see what you think about it. Give us a thumbs up, thumbs down. But it's something that we all worked on here and thought it fit the show, thought it fit our personalities really well. And I think it actually turned out really, really cool. So I'm going to put that out on Twitter. And won't you run off a couple of events that we've got?
Oh, yeah. CWF presents the 18th annual CWF Rumble. Saturday, October 6th at the Mid-Atlantic Sportatorium, Pleasantville, North Kakalaki. You can find out more information by visiting www.cwf247.com. NAWA Birthday Bash, two shows for the price of one. Saturday, October 6th, the American Legion Hall in Lenoir, North Carolina. You can find out more information by visiting NAWA's Wrestling Facebook page. And I just want to say real quick that I plan on attending the RWA show. I think it's not this weekend. It might be the following week. I think it's a Sunday. We're going to get to meet Brian Pillman Jr. I'm looking forward to that.
That'd be cool.
Yeah, I'm really looking forward to that. And also, we're going to have Jimmy Walker there. JJ from Good Times.
Oh, so, okay. I know what you're talking about. I think I have seen the ad for that. That'd be cool.
Yeah, so I'm looking forward to that. And getting to see Tommy Thomas. I haven't seen him since God was a boy. So looking forward to that. And we'll talk a little bit more about that next week. Positive, but lots of stuff went on in the world of professional wrestling, you know, this weekend. Just, you know, pretty dang incredible. The whole Cody thing, just quickly, I was so taken back by him saying the things he said. And if you've not seen it, you need to Google it. Because I really think that was a shoot. I really and truly do. I think he pissed.
It looked like he was pretty pissed. I mean, it looked like he was pretty upset.
You know, I'm Dusty's GD kid.
Yeah.
Real GD kid. And I'm like, oh, he done dropped the GD. Lord have mercy.
Yeah, he was a little red-faced over that. There's some other things going on in New Japan, too. Won't give too much away. I believe that there's a big thing happening in October with Naito and Los Ignite. I can never say it. Los
Ignobles.
De Japón. Yes.
De Japón.
They are going to announce a new member.
It's so funny. It's Spanish, and it's in Japan.
It's Japanese.
It's local.
Los Inigrables de Japón. I'll get it out eventually. I'll work on it. But yeah, it looks like they're going to be adding a new member. So I'd be interested to see that. Lots of great stuff happening. I want to go on and announce next week's guest because this one's special for us. We had put out a poll asking folks if they would like to hear legends on the show. And it just so happened that everything lined up and worked out the way things work out when you put in the work. And we're really excited to have the opportunity to speak to this guy, because if you're a fan of professional wrestling from years gone by, from the heyday, or our heyday, I should say.
Golden age, yeah.
The golden age of wrestling through the 70s and the 80s. This guy was all over the place with one fell slap.
Yeah.
Dr. D. David Schultz will be with us next week. He has a book out called Fake. And there's a lot to this guy's story, more than just the slap. I mean, there's a ton of interviews already floating around on the interwebs, on YouTube and all that. But we're going to go past the slap. I think that this is really important because of the time era that it happened in and what subsequently happened just a couple years after this incident. And it really opened up wrestling, or opened up the curtain behind pro wrestling. And I'm really interested to get his take on, you know, the Harley Race thing with the secrets of pro wrestling revealed and all the work that was put up into it until that point in keeping the sport legitimized in front of the curtain, what was really going on behind the curtain. That's what I'm really, really excited to find out about. So our guest next week will be Dr. D. David Schultz, and should be a pretty good show. I know it'll be a special show for us. So you have anything else that you'd like to add before we call tonight?
I would. I'd like to give a shout out to my BFF Caleb Conley for successfully defending the AML Heavyweight Championship against Shannon Moore, who was a replacement for Joey Janela, who was hurt.
Yes.
Got a little wild there. I saw in the pictures, you know, my boy can throw down. Just want to give him a shout out. Let him know that, you know, I'll see you probably the next time I'll see you. It will be at WrestleCade. So I'm looking forward to seeing that. And I'm also tickled pink. He's back in FIP. I'm hoping this means what I think it means, because FIP is associated with Evolve, which Evolve is associated with WWE. So I'm hoping maybe he can gain some ground and, you know, get his spot again.
We shall see.
But I'm just want to give that shout out to him, and we also wanted to give a quick shout out to Caleb's BFF, which is Zane Riley, who's got his own podcast now, which is about people who've done extra work in the WWE. And his first guest was John Schuyler, who's been very visual, very prominent in his extra work in the WWE, especially the cowboy, the singing cowboy there. So,
the Ricky Roberts deal?
Ricky Roberts, yeah. I can't remember what his name was, but yeah. So give that a listen. You know, want to support everybody's got a podcast, because we know the work that goes into making a podcast. And, you know, just for full disclosure, Bob does most of the work. I sit here and I look pretty. And I make friends really easily. So that's how we get a lot of our guests. So.
That's how it works, folks. You talk about pulling the curtain back. That's exactly how it all operates. Folks, thank you for listening to this episode of Live from the Armory Wrestling Show. No matter how you listened or where you listened at, make sure that you catch us on Talk Radio, iTunes, Stitcher, YouTube, and of course go to www.fnx.network. We'll be back here next Wednesday night, 7 o'clock Eastern, and remember, there's never a bad seat here at the Armory. Enjoy your week, and we'll see you later.
You have been listening to Live from the Armory Wrestling Show, the premier podcast of indie wrestling. Listen to us on blogtalkradio.com every Wednesday night at 7 p.m. Eastern Time. Subscribe to us on iTunes. Follow us on Twitter at From the Armory. We're also streamed worldwide on www.fnx.network. And we're also available on Stitcher. You can find us on Facebook at facebook.com/live.armory.9. If you like what you hear, please take a few moments to give us a 5-star rating on iTunes. Thank you for listening. See you next week.
911.
Officer, I'd like to file a report. I witnessed a robbery.
A robbery?
Yes, at Sonic. I saw a man steal a quarter-pound double cheeseburger and tots for only $2.99. He was about 6'1", brown hair, blue shirt, big smile.
Wait, so he did actually pay just $2.99? I better check this out. Boys, I'm going on lunch.
It's a steal, all right. The Car Hop Classic, a quarter-pound double cheeseburger or Slinger Plus Tots for only $2.99. This is how you Sonic.
Text not included. See menu for details for a limited time. Only participating Sonic drive-ins.